Thank you very much. Is this working? It seems to be working. Excellent. So thank you very much for inviting me here into. Does it still work?
Yes.
Okay. Into this beautiful, prestigious institution and this beautiful lecture room. So I'll talk about the first of our kind, and I promise I will not present you a forgery, a scientific forgery, to the best of my knowledge. And I'll focus on what makes humans unique. So the core of my talk will deal with things that separate us as modern humans from our distinct ancestors and relatives. And so I will focus mostly on brain evolution. But to give you the full story and to appreciate the, I would say, complexities of human evolution, we cannot start with the news that we just published about the earliest evidence for Homo sapiens, but we need to take a much deeper look in time and look 6 or 5 million years back to the evolution of upright walking. Because one of the hallmark features, obviously, of our lineage is that we have increased our endocrine capacity and brain size tremendously from our first upright walking ancestors, the Australopithecines, maybe known best for one of the representatives called Lucy, up into the brain sizes that we have in humans today and that were also present in Neanderthals. It's important to realize that the other hallmark feature of our lineage, upright walking, evolved much earlier. And the sequence of events is important because changing your locomotion from using all your limbs to just the hind limbs changed the body in a way that has consequences for brain evolution. And upright walking probably evolved around 6 million years in the rainforest, but for sure we know that it was fully established at 3.6 million years because we have the fossilized footsteps of upright walking hominins from East Africa that are dated to 3.6 million years ago. And so this is an ash layer from a volcano that can be dated exactly, and two hominins, probably representatives of the Lucy species, walked in here. It's unclear whether they were really, you know, a couple or romantically entangled, as suggested by this reconstruction here. But so there's absolutely clear evidence that upright walking preceded brain evolution by millions of years. And that is important because to be an efficient upright walking hominin, you have to change your anatomy. And those changes include changes to the pelvis that make it much harder for human women to give birth. So this is the reason here, this is the birth canal of a chimpanzee mother, and this is you know, a schematic of a chimpanzee fetus passing through the birth canal. And this is the reason why birth for a chimpanzee mother is usually a solitary event. It's even in zoos, where they are under 24-hour surveillance, it's almost impossible to film a chimpanzee mother giving birth because, you know, it's over very quickly. And as we all know, this is not true for human mothers. And it's important to appreciate that this constraint, this anatomical constraint on endocranial size in neonates will have an implication on how the brain grows and develops, and we'll revisit that in a few minutes. I want to give you even more context and show you things that are usually not shown in our publications and papers. And I think this might help you understand what is hard and exciting even about paleoanthropology. And what is hard usually is finding those fossils and making sense of them. So this is a picture of a lake. So 4 million years ago, this was a lake. And now this is in East Africa in a site called Galili. And after you negotiate with the Ethiopian authorities, you get permission to search for fossils in a certain area, and that's what we are doing here. And sometimes we find big things. So here we found the tusk of a mammoth. Initially, we just found this piece here, and this is me applying glue to this huge mammoth tusk. This is an entire skull. Here you can maybe see a little bit better. There's basically an entire mammoth stuck in the hill. That's the other side of the tusk. And just to give you like the proportions, this is me as a scale. So like the mammoth itself was, you know, the tusk alone was more than 2 meters tall. So this was surely an animal that inspired some fear in these early hominins. And those mammoths and other animals and the fossil remains, they're important for us to understand the environment and also give us an idea of when these fossil layers were deposited. But usually we go for sites like this. So that's what gets me excited. And on this picture, you see at least 15 fossils. Right? I'll highlight them. And every time I look, I see more. There's another one, for example. So this is how we find fossil specimens, as broken pieces of bones and fragments of teeth. Usually, especially in these early periods, we do not find complete skeletons because they were not buried. So these are accidental findings of fossils that need to be reconstructed, and that's what you do after you basically get down on your knees and start sieving and collecting all the pieces that you find, and then later in the camp you try to piece these puzzles back together. And we usually start by piecing the original fossils back together, but of course there's a limit what you can do with these fossils if pieces are broken and distorted, or if parts are missing, and that's what we use computer-based virtual reconstruction for. And I'll show you images of that as well. So let's go to the main topic of this lecture and talk about our own origins as a species. And there's absolutely no doubt that the genetic data of, I'm losing my microphone, the genetic data of humans living today, they point to an African origin. And also we have the oldest fossil evidence in Africa, but we know very little about the morphology and shape of these early hominins and these early humans. And the main problem is that the fossil evidence and the archaeological evidence is so scarce that we have major gaps, temporal and geographic gaps in the fossil record that make it hard to understand the population dynamics. So every field site, every new discovery will help us understand this puzzle of human evolution better. So we know, of course, what defines humans living today, modern humans, I would call them. In contrast to all other human species, modern humans have fairly small faces. We do not have these big superorbital tori, so brow ridges, if you so will. We have fairly square orbits, and importantly, we have very round brain cases. And we have derived features, or features that many people think are derived, like in an impression here that seems to be serve no function whatsoever. And it's called a canine fossa. And that separates us from everyone else, as I mentioned, including, for example, this Homo heidelbergensis specimen from Kabwe, or it's also called the Broken Hill specimen. Sometimes in the literature you find this as Homo rhodesiensis, because at the time it was found, this was still colonial Rhodesia, and now this is Zambia. And every textbook and every Wikipedia page that you will open today will tell you that this is a representative of the ancestor of both modern humans and Neanderthals. And what I will try to convince you of today is that this is very unlikely to be true. So let me try to explain why while I'm struggling with my microphone. So here you see a map of Africa, and you see early fossils that we have. And you see that there are huge gaps in the fossil record, geographic gaps. And that's because there are only very few circumstances under which you find fossils. And it's very unlikely that even if there were people, and we are pretty sure that there were people in Central Africa as well, but in rainforest environments, it's A, very hard to fossilize, and B, you wouldn't find them today. So that's why we have these fossil exposures here in East Africa and in South Africa and some in North Africa that I will mention in a minute. So these are the oldest known, or were the oldest known until we published our paper. So these are specimens from Ethiopia, Omo Kibish they are called, and they're dated to almost 200,000 years ago. So this is basically the textbook knowledge of what is the earliest Homo sapiens. It's 200,000 years ago. And there is another beautiful skull from East Africa, also from Ethiopia, the Herto skull that is dated to 160,000 years ago. And then, in the 60s, miners found this skull by accident in Jebel Yehud in Morocco. And this was believed to be 160,000 years old as well. And it never really made sense because it has an interesting feature of a fairly modern face and a very archaic brain case. So it looked more primitive than the presumably older specimens from East Africa. So most people thought of North Africa as basically a backwater of human evolution, something, and never considered that these specimens might have anything to do with our direct line of ancestry. So this is Africa seen from space, and this is the site Jebel Yehud. And as you can see here on this satellite image, it's part of the Sahara. That's a view from the site. It's beautiful, but it's in the middle of the desert today. And this is the Jebel. Jebel just means mountain, so this is the Jebel Yehud. And this is our team from the Max Planck Institute in Leipzig reopening the excavation from the 1960s and spending a lot of time and resources trying to find the old excavation and initially just trying to redate the site. Because my colleagues never really believed the 160,000-year-old date, so we sent our dating experts, and one of them was Daniel Richter, there to basically drill holes into the site and basically measure the local levels of radioactivity and get a better understanding of the local levels of radiation and redate those layers from which the fossils come from. And to make a long story short, and the story was really long, it was 10 years long, so they were able, with two different methods, to redate the site to 300,000 years ago, which makes the fossils from Jebel Yehud and also the stone tools more than 100,000 years older than the previously oldest early human. And importantly, while cleaning the section to drill those holes, my colleagues found new stone tools and new fossils. And the stone tools are incredibly important because they tell us something about a technological change, a technological shift in Africa, in these early Homo sapiens, because those stone tools, they do not look like the stone tools that we found in older fossil assemblages. So the old stone tool made by Homo erectus is called an Acheulean hand axe. They're huge and big. And these are much more gracile stone tools. And they include these pointed forms. And many believe I think there's good evidence to suggest that these points were used as spear tips. So we think that those Middle Stone Age tools, or some of them, were used to hunt animals at a distance. Right? So this is a huge change in hunting strategy and behavior, and will basically must have been a game changer for these people to be able to throw a spear and hunt large game at a distance. We also found new fossils that at least I find very beautiful. So we found a huge lower jaw, a mandible, and we found this crushed skull. So here you see my boss, Jean-Jacques Hublin. He's the head of the department, and he's the one who started the re-excavation. And he's pointing towards the brow ridges, or the supraorbital tori, of this crushed calvarium. And what this means is, together with the fossils that we found in the, that people found in the 1960s, and the fossils that were found in the Max Planck excavation, we now have fossil remains of five individuals of different ages, and presumably also different sexes. So these are the three beautiful crania. So that's what I could make out of the crushed skull. It really looks, it's as flat as a pizza box. But it preserves elements, undistorted elements of the face, and there's the new mandible going probably with one of the skulls found in the 1960s. And when you analyze the shape of these fossils in a comparative context and compare these fossils to other fossils like Neanderthals and Homo heidelbergensis and to modern humans living today, then what you find in this, so what I did is a shape analysis based on hundreds of measurement points. And what we are trying to cover here is the worldwide diversity of people living today, right? So we have all from all over the world, skulls and faces. And you see that basically the blue, which are the recent modern humans, they're completely distinct from Neanderthals and Homo heidelbergensis when it comes to facial shape. Absolutely no overlap. And even those early modern human fossils fall within the recent modern human variation, right? So even at 300,000 years ago, you would have faces that would not stick out in a crowd like this audience here. You see these many points here, and that's me trying to make as many reconstructions as plausible from all these distorted fragments. Because of course there's a reconstruction error. You know, if you have isolated pieces and you try to stick them back together, then there are multiple plausible ways of reconstructing these fossils. So in the end, we did nine different reconstructions and pretended in the analysis that instead of finding one crushed crappy skull, we found nine beautifully preserved skulls. And this is the range of variation. So there is a reconstruction error, but it doesn't matter for our conclusion because all of these reconstructions fall within the recent modern human cloud of variation. When we looked at brain shape, on the other hand, the story is very different. So again, you have a large variation of recent modern humans when it comes to brain shape, completely distinct from Neanderthals and Homo heidelbergensis, and also the ancestral shape from Homo erectus. And what's interesting is that the oldest Homo sapiens from Ehud and Omo, they fall completely outside the recent modern range of variation. So, and there seems to be a temporal trend within Homo sapiens. So the brain shape evolves within Homo sapiens. And it's important to stress, so this is a composite reconstruction taking the most complete cranium and fitting it to the most complete mandible. And what what this illustrates is that you have a fairly modern looking face already, but if you look at the skull from the side and look at the endocranial imprint, you see that it has a very archaic looking brain case. And importantly, it already has a brain volume that would fall within modern ranges of variation, right? So 1,400 milliliters, that's, you know, squarely within the endocranial volume variation of people living today. And to illustrate, without statistics, what the differences are and what I mean by archaic brain shape, I'm cutting open two CT scans of this skull from Morocco. As I said, this is around 300,000 years old. And this skull from Israel, from the Kafze cave, that is around 100,000 years old. So basically between here and here, we have 200,000 years of Homo sapiens evolution. And you see that if we create an imprint of the brain case and measure its volume, okay, they have very similar volumes, but in terms of shape, they're very different. And what's different is that these early Homo sapiens, they do not have these globular brains, they do not have bulging parietals, and they do have a fairly small cerebellum. We'll come back to that in a second. And with regards to the face, we see something very interesting. We see that if we compare these earliest Homo sapiens from Jebel Yehud to Homo erectus specimens that are more than a million years older, right? So this one is dated to 1.6 million years, this one to 300,000 years. This is Jebel Yehud compared to Homo heidelbergensis. And they are, you know, similar in age, I would say. And the textbooks that you can currently buy will make you believe that this is the ancestor of both Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. And I just don't think it's true, because it's much easier to evolve Jebel Yehud directly from something that is Homo erectus-like. So there's another thing that's important to mention, and that's the spread of modern humans across Africa. So we now, with the new date of what the old date of Jebel Yehud, put it that way, we have the oldest ones in North Africa, but we also have the specimens that I mentioned in East Africa, and there's an enigmatic cranium from South Africa that probably also belongs to Homo sapiens. And later on in time, we have more sites and better archaeological resolution. So there seems to be a spread very early on of modern humans diverging all over Africa. And not only we find those fossils, but we also find all over Africa those Middle Stone Age tools, including those pointed forms that were used as spears. So we think that a change in hunting behavior and hunting technology basically facilitated the spread of these early Homo sapiens across the entire African continent. And that this basically, this structure created by the sheer size of Africa played an important role in our evolution. Because what happened is that, okay, the reason why these early Homo sapiens were even able to go to Morocco is because around 350,000 years ago, the Sahara was not the desert that it is today, but it was green, right? Climatic changes, you know, every 50,000 years or so, the Sahara turns green. And this makes it possible and feasible for these hunter-gatherers to move along with their prey that they're hunting through these savanna environments, and they end up on the periphery of Africa. Then the Sahara gets drier again, and the people living up here get isolated for millennia from the other Homo sapiens. they develop their own, you know, mutations, their own customs maybe, and after a few thousand years, these people are able to merge again. So we think that one of the reasons why modern humans today are so diverse in their shape, even though we are so closely related to each other genetically, might be the reason is that we descend from a population that was deeply structured within Africa. So we now know that these Jebel Yehud fossils document an early stage of the Homo sapiens clade. We're not trying to move, you know, the cradle of humankind from East to North Africa. We're actually arguing that we evolved on a continental scale. And we have a modern facial, mandibular, and dental morphology, and a more primitive endocranial morphology. So the endocranial morphology is interesting because that tells us something about the brain, right? So let's look at these evolutionary changes in the endocranium a little bit in detail and try to understand how this might help us elucidate the evolution of cognition. And maybe also the differences between Homo sapiens and Neanderthals will help us understand why the Neanderthals disappeared. So as many of you will know, the Neanderthals are the only real Europeans. Everyone else, all other human species that we know of at this point, at this time, come from Africa. And so by the time modern humans arrive in Europe, the Neanderthals seem to retreat to the southern parts of Europe, and then eventually they disappear. And it's at this point absolutely unclear what happened, because we know that Neanderthals were extremely skilled hunters and were very well adapted to the harsh environments of the ice ages. So it's not absolutely intuitive why they would disappear. We know that both modern humans and Neanderthals produced similar stone tool technologies. They were very good hunters. They were, Neanderthals in particular, were hunting large game. And there seem to be initially very few differences, so you really have to look for the behavioral differences between modern humans, early modern humans, and Neanderthals. One of them seems to be that Neanderthals did not consume a lot of fish or any other freshwater resources. So even if they lived right next to the sea or next to a lake, they did not exploit those resources as much, for sure, as modern humans did. And that, of course, might have, you know, been just a sign of modern humans always having been extremely opportunistic when it comes to the exploitation of the environment. So we know that Homo sapiens ate, you know, small mammals and birds and fish, and that, of course, can give you a competitive edge in one way or another in harsh times. We also know that later in Homo sapiens, we have these beautiful expressions of symbolic behavior. And things that are similar to these cave paintings or these beautiful Venus figurines that you find all over Europe have not been found in Neanderthal contexts. Right? So what might the explanation or the reason for these perceived differences in behavior be? Well, for sure it's not brain size, because Neanderthals on average had even larger brains than people living today, as you can see from these endocranial imprints. So they had overlapping ranges of brain size, let's put it that way. But as I mentioned several times already, Neanderthals have these elongated brains, whereas modern humans have these globular brains. And the globularity in modern humans comes from having bulging parietals and expanded and an absolutely larger cerebellum here. What's interesting is that we are not born globular, right? So if you look at a neonate, a modern human neonate, and scale it up to the size of a Neanderthal adult, then you see that at the time of birth, we have very elongated brain cases and brains. And what this means is that the typical shape of Homo sapiens, or modern humans, let's put it that way, evolves or develops very, very late in ontogeny. So it develops after birth. To show you this in a statistical context, I'll show you a study I did together with colleagues where we measured endocranial shape variation in modern humans and in chimpanzees. And we looked at shape changes of the endocranium between birth and here. And this age group 2, this is the deciduous dentition is erupted, and here they become adults. So age group 6 is adults. Here are chimpanzee neonates, and they grow up to be adults. And what's interesting is that as soon as the deciduous dentition is erupted, the endocranial shape changes, they are basically the same. You could interchange those growth trajectories, and you would not find a difference in terms of the pattern of shape changes between humans and chimpanzees. But there seems to be a big difference here between birth and the eruption of the deciduous dentition. And we know what's happening here. We can visualize what's going on. Here are these changes. So in the first year of life, the cerebellum expands and the parietals start to bulge. So all the shape differences that separate a modern human adult from a Neanderthal adult, they develop in the first year of life. So what we wanted to know as the next step is whether Neanderthals also have a similar phase. We call this a globularization phase. And we wanted to know whether Neanderthals also have something similar. And to this end, we reconstructed on the computer using micro-CT data from two Neanderthal babies that were presumably buried. And that's why they are beautifully preserved, but they are fragmentary, right? So I spent 3 months on the computer, and I wish it would have been that easy. But okay, so this is a simulation of what I wish my life was like. So we piece these three-dimensional jigsaw pieces back together, we mirror image, and we do this over and over again to get multiple reconstructions to assess the estimation error and reconstruction error. And then we can compare modern human babies and Neanderthal babies. And what's interesting is that at the time of birth, we already have differences between modern humans and Neanderthals. The Neanderthal babies already have larger faces and taller orbits. So some of the characteristics that separate an adult Neanderthal from you and I, they are already present at the time of birth. But when we look at the imprints of their brain cases, their endocasts, they're almost indistinguishable. And that's true for both volume and shape. So both Neanderthal babies and modern human babies have these elongated brain shapes at the time of birth. And here, you can see this in this principal component space. So basically, here we have the Neanderthal babies and Neanderthal kids growing up to be adults, and they do not have this globularization phase. So there seems to be something unique in modern human brain development in the first year of life. So you might ask, okay, what happens before birth, right? Because it could be, of course, that even chimpanzees have a globularization phase, but it's just before birth and not after birth, right? So what we did is we tried to study the shape changes before birth. And before I show you what the results, I want to look again at those shape changes that happen after birth in modern humans. So you see, slightly exaggerated by a factor of 2 to make it more intuitive, these changes from an elongated to a more globular brain case or an endocranium, they involve an expansion of the cerebellum and a bulging of the parietal. And what you can see in this color coding, as opposed to the one that I showed you before, where the parietal was also lighting up red. Well, before we just looked at shape changes, but here we color code the relative size changes. And what you see here is that the cerebellum is actually expanding, but the parietal is bulging, but it's not really expanding. And what this means is that there's something inside the brain, a subcortical structure, increasing in volume and pushing out the parietals. So let's see if our closest living relatives have a globalization phase that is prenatal. And the reason why this is so important is because that, I think, would change the interpretation of what we're dealing with here. Because either it's something that's uniquely modern human, or it's something that is not uniquely modern human, but it's just shifted from prenatal to postnatal development. So we were looking at whether bonobos in particular had a prenatal globalization phase, and we also wanted to know whether growth rate affects brain shape. And we also tried to tackle another problem, and this other problem is that, of course, especially when we're dealing with fossils and also museum specimens, any cranium, we get these beautiful high-resolution scans, but of course, these are cross-sectional samples of individuals that died. And so it's interesting, of course, but it will not tell us something about individual growth and development. So what we did is we embarked on a multi-year collaboration with multiple zoos and studied early changes of brain shape in bonobo fetuses that are still alive. And to this end, we trained bonobo mothers to undergo ultrasound treatment with a normal human ultrasound apparatus. And the challenge was that the animals were not sedated, so we rewarded them for their participation, but we had to be really quick to get these scans. And in those lucky moments where everything worked, you get pictures like this, and this would be like an ideal case of the resolution you would get with a high resolution ultrasound technique that you would also use to monitor a human pregnancy today. And then I compared using simple clinical measures, dividing the frontal occipital diameter by the biparietal diameter and create a ratio to assess the overall shape of the skull. And these are clinical data, so that's what's happening in Homo sapiens, right? So this, and you see that bonobos do something completely different before birth, right? So we know from this is that it's not a simple shift in developmental timing. There is really a prenatal difference in the trajectory of brain development, let's put it that way. You notice here that here's one point called Haiba. Here's another point, a postnatal point, Haiba. So what happened is that Haiba's baby, Haiba was the bonobo mother in a German zoo, and we had a beautiful scan in the 22nd gestational week. And unfortunately, this bonobo baby died. So it was a healthy baby, full-term baby, and it died almost 5 months after birth. And the zoo was generous enough to allow us to CT scan the specimen. So now we have of the same individual, even longitudinal data, so we can compare the postnatal shape to the prenatal shape. And what's interesting is that if you scale down the postnatal shape or the postnatal skull to fetal size, you see there's no shape change whatsoever, which would you would not find in humans. In humans, you in the same period of time, you would have this change from this elongated to this globular brain shape. And so we know that, bonobos also undergoes, they become a little bit more globular. You maybe saw that there's an increase in this ratio early on, but it's not directly before birth, so there's something more complicated going on. So it really seems to be that modern humans do something else than our closest living ancestors. And we also found a connection between the growth rate and shape changes, so the more rapidly parts of the brain expand, the rounder the brain becomes, which is something you would expect, but it's nice to be able to show. I should pause here a little bit and try to defend myself, because I've been going on and on about brain shape changes and promised you to talk about cognition. And I want to make sure to be absolutely clear that I'm not trying to argue that there is a direct link between brain shape and cognition, right? I'm not trying to reestablish a new kind of phrenology here, quite the opposite. I don't think that brain shape per se is under selection. So I'm not trying to say that having a rounder brain makes you want to create art or go fishing. But I think that these changes in the brain and brain shape, they tell us something about the timing of and growth rate during prenatal and perinatal brain development. And it's also interesting that these large differences that we see between modern humans, chimpanzees, and Neanderthals, they happen in the first year of life, right? And this is a period that is absolutely critical, I'm sure I do not have to convince you of that, for cognitive development. And the reason for this is that we are born with almost the same number of nerve cells that we will have as adults, but at the time of birth, there are hardly any connections between them. Right? There are some connections, obviously, but in those first years of life, the network structure of the brain is being built under the impressions and stimuli of the environment. So when you grow and how you grow and what you experience during this brain growth will affect the network wiring of the brain. And this is basically the way that brain shape may be connected and linked to cognition, because the brain shape serves as a mere proxy for those differences in speed and growth rate. So we know, of course, that I said there were no connections. This was a lie, obviously, or an exaggeration. So we know that some of the major pathways in human brains are already established very, very early on, prenatally. But basically, the explosion of synapses and this, including the synaptic pruning, that is really critical for understanding the cognition. And that might be a difference between humans and our closest living relatives. And to come back to the evolutionary relationships between Homo heidelbergensis and Homo sapiens that I alluded to in the beginning of the talk. We have another piece of evidence that is relevant here. And from genetic data, we now know that Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalensis share the last common ancestor that lived around 600,000 years ago. I mean, that number in and of itself has an error, of course, but the ballpark number, I think, will hopefully stand the test of time. And in the textbooks, just out of convenience, I would say, you will see that basically around 600,000 years ago, we have Homo heidelbergensis in Africa. So most people assume that, the last common ancestor was Homo heidelbergensis, and that fits with the genetic data. But as I showed you before, looking at those shape differences between Homo sapiens and Homo heidelbergensis in their faces, I think that scenario is very, very unlikely. So I think what's happening is that Homo sapiens has a much, much deeper root in something that is very Homo erectus-like, and that Homo heidelbergensis is not on our lineage. Homo heidelbergensis belongs to the Neanderthal lineage, but not to the Homo sapiens lineage. And we have these changes, so we have Homo heidelbergensis in both Africa and Europe, and within Europe they evolved to become the classic Neanderthals. And that is also backed up by genetic data from ancient DNA. And the evidence we have from Jebel Yehud basically shows us that Homo sapiens is an evolving lineage, right? So at 300,000 years ago, we have this random snapshot, if you so will, between you know, something that is much more primitive looking, much more Homo erectus looking than we previously thought, and with a fairly modern looking face, but the brain shape and possibly also brain function evolves within our species. So that, I think, is basically the main take-home message of my presentation. So I want to thank you for your attention and having me, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.